Niagara Falls. We also welcome our YouTube viewers. We're glad you are with us today as we join together in this holy historical place. May God bless us with understanding and grace. I need to tell you that Carol Dashnell did have her hip surgery finally on Wednesday. She is home and will be recovering for a while, so I'm pinch hitting for her. I'm sure she would appreciate phone calls and cards. I did call and talked with her yesterday, and her friend Kay is staying with her, so things are looking good and she's very optimistic. A couple of announcements. The office hours, now that winter is almost over, are going back to 9 in the morning till 1 in the afternoon. We had changed them because of the snow plowing. We are thankful for John and missing Tracy this morning. Thank you for doing the YouTube, John. And also for the other John, John Goddard, who's our lay reader this morning. And for someone who's not a John, for Mark and music. Birthdays and anniversaries. It's the beginning of a new month.
Today there's a little twist with my joke. I have an announcement. I'm getting a new pet. It's a hamster. So I have a joke that represents it. What's a hamster's favorite game? Hide and cheek.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, Selena. Have something then to remember all we can laugh and think of Selena. Let us pray. Father God, whose beautiful creation surrounds us, hear us as we pray both silently and out loud for all who are sick, sorrowful, grieving, rejoicing, and thankful. Continue to be with Carol Dashnell as she recovers from surgery. We pray for your healing presence with Abe, Mark, and Bill. Help us, Lord, to spread your message of love wherever we go. In your name we pray. Amen. Our opening sentences this morning. There is so much we do not understand, so many mysteries in this life of faith, but some things are certain. We do know. Our help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. God is our refuge and our keeper and shade. Let us lift our eyes to God. Oh, sorry, I forgot. Peace of the Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Join me for the call to worship that's printed in your bulletins. God of the Sahara and the Amazon, maker of dry places and wetlands, we come before you with parched hearts, for living in this world has made them so. Holy One, your ability to renew us is unmatched.
You renew us from within and without.
Ancient of Days, you held us in the beginning. Holding us now,
we reach out to you and draw as close as we can with our worship.
Divine One, we are increase our desire to embody your love more fully. Source of grace, we confess that sometimes when we're tempted, we don't resist. Sometimes when we could do good, we don't because it seems too hard. These are the times that we need your grace the most. Instead of giving up on us, you transform us as we open ourselves to you. For grace that abounds as needed, when needed, we give you thanks.
All that God made is good. God made us, and we are empowered to be good and to do good. Grace and mercy make goodness possible always and in all ways. Thanks be to God.
For illumination, prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture reading today is Psalm 32, found on page 440 of your pew Bibles. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Selah. When I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity, I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Selah. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At a time of distress, the rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance. Selah. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
second reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But Jesus answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to Jesus, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship him, worship the Lord your God, and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. One of my favorite books is called The Art of Possibility. Someone suggested it to me about 20 years ago, and I read it then, and I have read it a couple of times since then. It made so much sense to me, and I embraced some of its ideas so thoroughly that I forgot that they really came from that book, and they weren't my own ideas. But every time I read it, I learn something new. It's written by a husband and wife team. The husband is a violinist and an orchestra conductor, and he's on the faculty at a music school. The wife is a psychologist and a therapist, and she too is on the faculty at a college or a university. They have a really good combination of ideas and practical implications for these ideas that they share throughout the book. There are two lessons that have stuck with me in my most recent reading of the book. And I feel like they are really great lessons for us to hold on to during this season of Lent. The first one is to remember that we don't need to take things too seriously, and that we can have a little bit of fun in life. And the second one is that everyone starts with an A. So since I'm guessing many of you haven't been in school for a while and you don't really think about grades in your everyday life, let's say that everyone starts at the top. You've already achieved what you need to achieve. You're welcome. You're okay. You don't have to do anything but be who you are. So let's take a step, a moment, and think about our temptation to get caught up in how important so many things are. So maybe we think about the way that we dress or how we speak to the people that we want to impress. Maybe we think about solving a difficulty with a friend or a family member. Maybe it's something where we feel like our neighbors wish we did a better job in our yard and we want to keep up with them, so we spend a lot of time or effort working outside, whether we enjoy it or not. The truth is, though, everything will work out. Our efforts might matter and make a difference. Our worry, our concern might matter and make a difference, or it might not. I had to two friends that I talked to this week, and they both mentioned that they hadn't gotten very much sleep the night before, and I said, well, why is that? You know, are you always not sleeping at night, or was there something special? And they both explained to me that they often don't sleep at night because they're working out something in their head. So they're playing through scenarios and trying to figure out solutions. So really what they're doing in the middle of the night instead of sleeping is they're worrying about something they can do nothing about in the middle of the night. So I kind of mentioned to them maybe they should let those things go and not try so hard to be perfect. They didn't really appreciate it, but it's true. We don't have to worry about things so much because our worry doesn't really affect the outcome. Our job is to do our best, to be who we are, to be authentic, and to go into situations and respond the best way we can. If we worry about it and we play through every scenario we can imagine, even so, we're probably going to miss the one that actually happens, and all of that worrying we have done will not really change the outcome. We don't have to take all of these things in our everyday life so seriously. We have to be who we are, show up when we're supposed to show up, be authentic when we show up, and that should take care of it. It's going to turn out okay. We can't influence nearly as many variables as we like to tell ourselves we can. We're not in charge of everything. We're in charge of ourselves. And all that energy and effort that we put into worrying and playing things out in our minds doesn't really make a very big difference. So instead of spending so much time worrying, we can have more time for fun and relaxation and letting our mind be present in the here and now and sleeping through the night. The second idea that sticks with me is this idea about everyone starts with an A. It's related to the first and different. You remember back in the day when you were in school, and you worked hard to get good grades. But sometimes you missed learning the big picture stuff because you were so worried about taking the tests. When we think about our grades, we focus on what we think we are supposed to learn rather than spending time letting all the learning come together and synthesize in our brains. There's the age-old question that comes up in most classrooms at one time or another. When the teacher brings up a new subject a few days before the test, and one of the students raises their hand and says, "Is this going to be on the test?" They're trying to decide how much attention they should pay in that classroom lesson of the day. If we aren't worrying about grades, then we have time to just listen. We do our best, we pay attention, and we begin to synthesize the learning that is before us, rather than just figuring out what we're supposed to know in order to prove that we have learned something. But we have become a society of measurement. So even if it isn't our grades, we measure how fast somebody can do something. We see how many widgets a person can take care of in a period of time. I know at the grocery store, one of the ones I shop at regularly has a big board at the front of the checkout area with people's initials and how many items per minute they can scan through the thing, what their average time is. Well, you know, I'd rather spend a few seconds, not an interminable amount of time, but a little bit of time interacting with the cashier. I want them to be efficient, but I don't want them to ignore me completely just so they can move up a notch on that list of how fast people scan. There's a fine line between efficiency and then really turning people into measuring doesn't always come out with the best outcome. Being fast isn't the only quality that we need in people that are taking care of our groceries or any other sort of thing that is going on. There's more than speed necessary for a good community. Engaging in life as though we have already gotten the best grade allows us freedom to try new things, to behave differently, to learn more about a particular subject. The author, the husband, the violin player, wrote about how when he told his students that they had an A the first day of class, the ones who were a little more timid were more willing to play with a little more abandon. And they began to play with a more musical sense because they weren't worried about making a mistake. So maybe they would play the wrong note, but they would play with great musicality. And it may have been a completely different experience for them. That works throughout life. When we're able to let go of our concerns about making a mistake, we can be more joyful in the things that we do, and we can bring people along with us and invite people in to experience things with us because we're not so worried about being perfect. Lent is a time for to try these ideas, to embrace them. Because as we remember the days when Jesus was tempted there in the wilderness, we enter into this journey with him. In these next weeks, we'll be considering what it means to be tempted and how we might move through that time and continue to be faithful. We are sometimes tempted by expectations, and we are sometimes telling ourselves that we have to live up to the expectations of others. Jesus went into the wilderness immediately after his baptism. He had just been told through the Holy Spirit that he was the Son of God, the Beloved, and now he's out in the wilderness. No food, no drink, no companionship. 40 days and 40 nights, and so you can imagine that he was indeed hungry and thirsty and lonely, and the arrival of the tempter might have felt like a relief initially because at least he was no longer alone. Isolation is powerful in causing us to make difficult choices or poor choices. Because after a time of isolation, sometimes we're just so glad to see someone, even if it's a person that we know might not be good for us, and we give in to temptation and do what they want. And the next thing we know, we're caught into some difficult situation. So here Jesus is, tempted, hungry, vulnerable. And the tempter asked the question, if you are the Son of God, try this. Other translations say, since you're the Son of God. Either way, it's an invitation to do something that he knows in his heart that he doesn't want to do. You can do anything, you're the Son of God. God's going to take care of you no matter what you do. Turn the stones to bread. Throw yourself from the highest height. Take control of the world around you. All this can be yours. Why do you continue to suffer this way? Do it. But Jesus refuses. And the story of Jesus is a story about his incarnation, the humanness of this moment in time. Jesus had faith that God would save him from all this suffering, but he knew he had to hold on to that faith. He knew that he didn't want to give in to the temptation, no matter how inviting it was in that moment. that while he was trusting God to take care of him, he too had to trust that God would do it, or he had to know that God would do it in God's time. Sometimes we are not prepared to wait for God, and we want to rush God along. So here we are, early in Lent, and we're invited to have faith and to have patience. We know that we're not alone in this journey of life, and we trust in God to hear our cries of hunger and thirst, our cries about injustice, our cries of frustration. God hears them all. And at the end of the story in the wilderness, the angels came and tended to Jesus. And at the end of our story, or within the midst of our story, God comes and tends to us in our frustration, in our anger, in our loneliness. God tends to us when we give in to temptation and when we withstand temptation. We are invited into the arms of God's mercy. We face temptations every day. We strive to be the best, to take everything too seriously. We imagine that we have more influence on the outcome of situations than we can possibly have. We live in a time where results are expected and the accumulation of things or wealth are what are considered most important. And so we are surrounded by temptation day after day after day. And if we can remember not to take everything so seriously, and that we have already received the best grade we can get, we can withstand those temptations that knock on us day after day after day. In the kingdom of heaven, measurement and success are different. We don't measure the same things in the kingdom of God as we do in our everyday lives. We have already gotten the best grade. We have already been measured and declared that we are enough. So we can be creative. We can let go of the worry. We can take more risks. We can do things differently. If they don't go the way we hope, it doesn't matter because we've already gotten an A. We've already been known. We are already loved. We are not alone. We can try differently. We can be who we are without the fear of being measured and found wanting and being rejected. We can have faith in God and know that we will be cared for no matter what. No matter what. And that's the good news of this story. We are known and loved by God. No matter what. So, as we move through this Lenten season, I invite you to live as though you are known and loved, as though you have been accepted for who you are, and take some risks. Try something new, and know that you will not be left behind. You are loved. offering in the plate here at the front of the church. All that we have comes from God, and we give thanks to God with our generous gifts. Now we're going to have a little bit of an audible and depart from our bulletin. So on Ash Wednesday, we were going to do this, and then we had ice. And then on last Sunday, we were going to do this, and we had ice. So I want to, we're not going to do the ashes this morning, but I am going to bring down this bowl. And for those who would like to, I want to invite you to come forward and maybe pick a stone that you might carry with you during these coming days of Lent to remind you to pause, to not take things too seriously, to remember that you are known and loved by God, that you've already gotten an A, and to use this as a token throughout this season to remind you. And then when you come back on Easter, I invite you to bring it, and if you'd like to, we'll do a thing with the stone